In the intro to thermodynamics tutorial, we saw that Gibbs free energy is a way to quantify the spontaneity or favorability of a process. Just like rocks naturally roll downhill, all processes naturally tend to go toward lower energy, which is higher stability. So spontaneous processes start at higher energy and go toward lower energy, resulting in a negative delta G, which is defined as G final minus G initial. These spontaneous processes release energy, which can dissipate into the surroundings as heat or be harnessed to do work. Non-spontaneous processes go from low to high energy, have a positive delta G, and require energy to be put into the system. As an analogy, think about a marble on an uneven surface. The height of that surface represents free energy. The higher the surface, the higher energy the marble, and the less stable it is, because if it could, it would roll downhill. The marble starts at point A, with some free energy G initial, or GI. Another part of the surface, point B, has a lower free energy, GF, for G final. Naturally, this marble would, if it could, roll from A to B, from G initial to G final, toward lower energy and more stability. There's a force driving the marble to roll downhill. This results in a negative delta G, and it tells us that the process from A to B is favorable, or spontaneous. Remember that spontaneity doesn't mean the marble can roll downhill, it only means that it would if it could. We can also define a delta G for the reverse process. Now, G initial is at point B, and G final is at point A. As you can see, delta G for this reverse process is positive, and the same magnitude as it was for the forward process. This is true in general. The delta G of a forward and reverse process have the same magnitude, but opposite signs. Now imagine there's a hill between point A and point B. In order for the marble to get to point B at all, it needs a push. It needs to be given energy, enough to get to the top of the hill. Once there, the marble can roll down toward lowest energy, or GF. The amount of energy that must be given to the marble is the difference between the top of the hill, which is often defined as having energy G double dagger, and point A, with energy G initial. This amount of energy, indicated by the orange line, is called the activation energy, or E sub A, energy of activation. The reverse process also has an activation energy, which in this case is larger than the activation energy of the forward process. These activation energies affect the rate at which the marble moves. The study of rate is called kinetics, which is different from thermodynamics. Likewise, many chemical processes have an energy barrier that must be overcome in order for the process to take place. As an example, think about the first step in glycolysis, the phosphorylation of glucose. In this reaction, a covalent bond in ATP is broken, forming ADP and a phosphate group. That phosphate group forms a covalent bond with glucose to form glucose-6-phosphate. Over the course of the reaction, free energy decreases. Glucose and ATP have a higher free energy than do glucose-6-phosphate and ADP, so the delta G is negative and the reaction is spontaneous. But in order for this reaction to happen, glucose and ATP must collide at just the right orientation, with enough speed. The molecules must be distorted into an unfavorable shape, and bonds must be both broken and formed. These things require energy input. The amount of energy they require is the activation energy. This energy can come from heat, which raises the kinetic energy of the starting materials. But for biological processes, heating up a cell isn't a feasible solution for making a reaction happen. We operate at a very narrow temperature range, and our proteins can denature if our temperature gets out of that range. Instead, we use enzymes to increase the likelihood that reactions proceed. Enzymes are proteins that catalyze reactions. To catalyze a reaction means to make that reaction occur more quickly. Catalysis does not change the starting materials or the products. It only makes the conversion from one to the other more likely. Enzymes do this by tightly and specifically binding the starting materials, called the substrates. Substrates can bind through ionic, hydrogen, and even covalent bonds. Additionally, hydrophobic interactions can contribute to substrate binding. Generally, each single interaction is weak, but many of these interactions together are strong. Because many interactions must all be involved in order for the substrates to bind, only particular substrates will fit the binding pocket. This specificity is based on size and charges of the substrates. Binding to the enzyme brings the substrates close together and in the correct orientation so that it is more likely that they will undergo the conversion into products. Let's apply this to the phosphorylation of glucose. This reaction, which is unlikely to proceed at body temperature, is catalyzed by an enzyme called hexokinase. The 3D structure of hexokinase is very important for the specific interactions between hexokinase, ATP, and glucose. The folded form of hexokinase has pockets that very specifically fit ATP and glucose because of their size and charges. Here, I've drawn some hypothetical interactions between an enzyme and their substrates to demonstrate this principle. Once both substrates are bound to hexokinase, their interaction with the protein causes hexokinase to change shape. Because the substrates are bound, hexokinase no longer interacts with itself in the same way, so it changes conformation. This conformational change brings the substrates close together. At the same time, it orients ATP and distorts it in a way that breaks the covalent bond between a phosphate group and ADP. This happens while the substrates are in close enough proximity that a covalent bond is formed between glucose and phosphate, resulting in glucose-6-phosphate. The bound products, glucose-6-phosphate and ADP, interact differently with the enzyme. Maybe they no longer fit in the binding pocket. The products are then released. Without anything bound to hexokinase, the enzyme returns to its original conformation. How does enzyme catalysis relate to Gibbs free energy? Here's our energy diagram for the uncatalyzed reaction. But with hexokinase, the activation energy is lowered. The path between the substrates and the products is now different and requires less energy. Hexokinase doesn't change the free energy of glucose, ATP, glucose-6-phosphate, or ADP. The substrates and the products are exactly the same as if the reaction had occurred without hexokinase. This is true in general. Catalysis does not change the free energy of the substrates or the products. As a result, catalysis does not change delta G. But catalysis does allow for an unlikely reaction to proceed or to proceed at a faster rate. Hexokinase lowers the activation energy of the conversion of glucose into glucose-6-phosphate. Enzymes affect the barrier in either direction, whether moving from A to B or from B to A. There are two major factors that determine the rate at which the process proceeds in either direction: activation energy and concentration. Let's look at activation energy first. If the free energy at point B is much lower than the free energy at point A, in other words, if the delta G of the reaction is negative when going from A to B, but positive when going from B to A, then even with the enzyme, the activation energy is lower in the forward direction than it is in the reverse direction. It's lower by exactly that quantity, delta G. If delta G is negative enough in the forward direction, then the reaction will hardly happen at all in the reverse direction at physiological temperature. There's always some chance that it'll happen, but with a large delta G, this chance is so small as to be insignificant. These reactions are often referred to as irreversible reactions, although at a high enough temperature, some molecules could proceed in the reverse direction. Imagine now that the difference between the free energy of the starting point and the free energy of the ending point is very small. Naturally, the process would go toward point D because it's slightly lower in energy, but there's not a huge driving force. The delta G may be small enough that the difference in stability between starting materials and products is negligible, and these reactions are reversible. This doesn't mean that the reaction happens easily or quickly. Remember that the rate of a reaction is more about activation energy than it is about delta G. The activation energy could still be large enough that it will not happen in either direction without the help of an enzyme. Lowering the activation energy affects the barrier in both directions. In this case, because delta G is so small, the activation in either direction is about the same. So how does concentration affect the likelihood of a process occurring in a given direction? Think about the second step of glycolysis as an example, which is the isomerization of glucose-6-phosphate into fructose-6-phosphate. These two molecules have very similar free energies, so the delta G of the process is close to zero. This reaction requires breaking a covalent bond and forming a different covalent bond, and these things require a lot of energy. In other words, the reaction has a high activation energy. In the body, an enzyme called phosphoglucose isomerase reduces the activation energy of the reaction. But because delta G is about zero, Reducing the activation energy allows the process to go in either direction. The barrier that needs to be overcome is close to the same, whether moving from glucose-6-phosphate to fructose-6-phosphate or the reverse, and this barrier can be overcome under normal cell conditions. If there's a lot of glucose-6-phosphate, or G6P, around, maybe right after an individual has eaten a meal, then it's pretty likely that G6P encounters the enzyme. Every time a glucose-6-phosphate molecule binds to the enzyme, there's some chance it'll be converted into fructose-6-phosphate, or F6P. If there's less F6P around, then F6P is less likely to encounter the enzyme, so it's less likely that G6P is made. This is how concentration plays a role in the direction of a reversible reaction. A reversible reaction generally proceeds in the direction toward lower concentration. Let's wrap this tutorial up with a quick review of what we've seen so far. Here's a reaction coordinate diagram, showing free energy on the y-axis and the course of reaction on the x-axis. In this hypothetical reaction, A and B form C. Let's say the free energy of A and B is here, and the free energy of C is here. Delta G, which is equal to G final minus G initial, is small but positive. In other words, the reaction is not spontaneous in this direction. Let's say there's a fairly large energy barrier to this reaction, so the activation energy is high. This is the energy required for this process to happen. An enzyme lowers the activation energy without affecting either G initial or G final, and thus without affecting delta G. The enzyme does this by binding the substrates, bringing them into close proximity, and orienting them in a way that makes it more likely they'll interact to form C. After the reaction is complete, C is released from the enzyme, and the enzyme returns to its original form, able to catalyze more reactions. Molecule C can also bind to the enzyme, and the enzyme can distort C in such a way that it makes it more likely to break into A and B. Here's the activation energy for that reverse process, with a negative delta G. We may expect that the reaction will proceed more quickly in the reverse direction, from C to A and B, than in the forward direction. This is because the activation energy is smaller in that direction. But if there's a whole lot of A and B around, and not very much C, then it's more likely that the enzyme will collide with A and B, so the reaction rate is faster in the forward direction, from A and B to C. As a summary, here's the difference between thermodynamics and kinetics. Thermodynamics deals with spontaneity, and thus with free energy and delta G. Thermodynamics only tells us about the free energy of the starting materials and the products. It tells us whether a process would, if it could, proceed in one direction or the other. Thermodynamics tells us nothing about the path between the beginning and the end, or about the rate at which the process happens. Kinetics, on the other hand, deals with rate of reaction and thus with activation energy. Kinetics tells us something about the path between the start and the end. It allows us to understand the speed at which a process occurs.